There's something about the design of our bodies that lets us know that we're not here by accident. There's something about the design of our bodies, how we are made and how we function, that simply goes beyond the physical. When David began to examine and when he began to think about his own body, he said, I praise you, O Lord, because I am fearfully made. But then he said, I praise you, O Lord, because I am wonderfully made. That's right. There's something wonderful. There's something beyond words. There's something incomprehensibly beautiful and unique about each and every one of us. And the New Testament expounds upon this because the Old Testament talks about us being body and soul, but the New Testament talks about us being body, soul, and spirit. In other words, we are tripartite, very much like the Trinity of God himself. But in any case, David chooses to talk about us in these words. He says that we are wonderfully, we are beautifully, we are fashionably, and we are mysteriously made. And my brothers and sisters, that is how we ought to see ourselves. And we ought to, just like David, give God the praise and the honor and the glory for it. Now, I can't help but to think that when David wrote this song, his mind went back to the creation story where God created Adam and Eve. You know, the Bible says that God formed Adam. He formed the first man out of the dust of the ground. And then the Bible says that he breathed into him the breath of life. And it said that man became a living soul. And this first man, he must have been something else, because the Bible says out of him God made the woman. And it says that he fashioned the woman and he designed her and he uniquely created her just as he had done the man, so that she might be a helpmate, so that she might be a companion to Adam. And I can't help but to think that David was inspired by all of this when he said in verse 13 of our text, when he said that God created his inmost being and that God knit him together in his mother's womb, almost like God was some kind of designer with a needle and a thread. And he took our muscles and he took our sinews and he took our tendons and he took our veins and he wove them around the inmost parts of our body. He wove them around our organs and then he knit them together around our skeletal frame. And David said, God did all of this in the secret place of our mother's womb. But then David in our psalm, he took it a step further and he says, all of this was done in the very depths of the earth. It was almost like he was saying, when God formed Adam from the dust of the ground, he had every single one of us in his mind, so that in a very real sense, we all come from the dust of the earth, just like Adam. We all come from the very depths of the earth itself, because we all come from Adam. All right? And so this psalm, it points to the incomparable and creative genius of God. And when David recognized that, he lifted up his voice in praise and in reverence and in stupendous awe at the mighty workings of the Lord. And we should see ourselves as a marvelous work. We should see ourselves as a marvelous craftsmanship of God. And we ought to, you know, we ought to be able to sing along with the hymn writer who once wrote, he said, oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands hath made, I see the stars. He said, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. He said, then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Oh, Lord, you know, every now and then, we ought to be able to sing that song. We ought to be able to look at the stars, and we ought to be able to say, how great thou art. But then we ought to be able to look at one another and say, I praise you, O God, because I am fearfully and I am wonderfully made. Now, my brothers and sisters, let me tell you how we should not see ourselves. We must not look at ourselves through a centuries-old degrading and demeaning and racial Eurocentric lens that still affects many of us today. And I even hate using the word race because the Bible says in Acts 17, chapter verse 26, that God has made from one blood all nations of men to dwell upon the face of the earth. There is one race, and that is the human race. Now, there are different ethnic groups within that race, but God said, but the Bible says that the Lord has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell upon the face of this earth. And I also want you to understand, before I say anything else, I want you to understand that I believe in the beauty of people from every ethnic group among whom we are by no means the least, all right? Ever since we set our foot upon the soil of this land, we have been living under a pale Eurocentric canopy that in some ways has kept the light of God from shining on our faces like an overcast day. And we have been given Eurocentric glasses to wear of a certain kind so that we see most everything from that perspective. We see ourselves and our family members and our neighbors who look like us sometimes from that perspective. We see our hair from that perspective. We see our skin tone from that perspective. We see the world from that perspective. We see Africa even from that perspective. Yeah? Even though the indigenous or the native people of Africa have the most varied skin tones and hair and facial features of any people in the world without Caucasian mix, some of us still see Africans from an unrealistic, unflattering perspective of lies that has been told to us by people with a warped and an ugly slave master mentality. We see the world sometimes through those Eurocentric lenses and from that perspective. But in most cases, I don't care what we've tried to do to fit in, that perspective hadn't been all that helpful to us now, has it? For example, even though the black middle class has doubled or perhaps tripled since the late 80s, our children still rank among the lowest in the educational system when it comes to their grades and when it comes to their test scores. Even though many of us are doing better than our grandparents did, the neighborhoods that we grew up in, they're quickly deteriorating, all right, as another demographic moves in to reoccupy the cities. Even though more of us are assimilating into the larger culture, and there's nothing particularly wrong with that, except for the fact that we become less noticeable and less effective as a group, our little girls and our little boys, as of 2008, still think that white girls, white dolls, are prettier than black dolls. Now, that is in no way amazing to me, because this canopy that we have lived under for four centuries has seeped into our minds and it has seeped into our bones so much so that we call beautiful whatever they call beautiful, more or less. For example, ever since the advent of television until very recently, most commercials that talked about beauty of skin or beauty of hair showed people of European background. That's right. Day after day after day, our minds have received these images. As a matter of fact, even before television was in its heyday, long before television came along, some of us began to think that we would be accepted more by the larger culture the more we were able to look like them, at least in some respects, or the more we talk like them. I'm not talking about the correct pronunciation of words, but I'm talking about in tone and inflection, opting for higher voices rather than the melodious vibrato that has the background of Africa on the baseline. The more of us tried to talk and look like them, the more we felt that we would be accepted. And you know, I want you to understand, I'm not criticizing any one of us because of the nature of the oppression out of which we have come. You know, sometimes you got to do whatever you got to do to survive. But can you imagine the mental and the psychological brainwashing that our people went through that was passed down from generation to generation to generation. Can you imagine children growing up in that atmosphere, living in that atmosphere with no defenses, no education, hearing day in and day out how they are nothing, and they looked at how their parents were treated, and they began to despise themselves, and they passed that same hatred down to their children who passed it on down, huh? Can you imagine being hearing all your life, you are good for nothing, low life? Can you imagine hearing, you animal? That's what I heard a Ferguson police officer say about the rioters in Ferguson, Missouri. I heard this with my own ears on CNN. Can you imagine hearing somebody say, your skin is ugly, your hair is nappy? You know, I despise every single one of those terms and any kind of word that is related to that, especially when we use them, because I know that they come straight from the plantation. They come straight from a culture of oppression and ignorance and greed and lust and lies and hatred. That's where they come from. Now think about this. Rarely will you hear any of them saying to each other, your hair is a sticky, greasy, matted together, tangled or mess. You don't hear those kind of things from them, do you? Besides, and I think this is a good thing, they have had centuries of hair care products designed for their hair. You see, we are just now, in some cases, recognizing the beauty of our own hair. And some sisters right now, they're learning how to work with their natural hair, huh? Even after it has been relaxed. And they're learning how to utilize different styles for their hair. And that's something, my brothers and sisters, that we need to pass on to the next generation. You know, when I was a kid, I learned that every black man's hair has a unique wave pattern to it if he will attend to it and if he will take care of it, huh? You know, let me tell you, I used to watch my daddy comb his hair in the morning and the routine that he would use to do it, huh? Now, my daddy's hair is of a different grade than mine, all right? And so he would wet his hair, all right, and he would get that comb, and he would comb those curls to the side and make them straight. And then he would put Dax, or that waving hair grease, in his hair, all right, to give it that slick, shiny look. And for a long time, because that was my example, I did the same thing, huh? I put my hair under that water. I parted to the side, all right? I put some wax or some waving hair grease on it. And let me tell you something. It did look good for a while, particularly in the wintertime. But when it got hot, my hair would kind of dry up, huh? And it becomes somewhat hard, all right? But now one day, listen to me, one day after I was grown, I was in St. Louis, and I had left that Dax or that waving hair grease at the house. And I just washed my hair, and I was looking for something to put on my head. And so I began to look through my father-in-law's cabinet, and I found his hair grease. And what I found was that Iso Plus hair grease, hold up now, with castor oil, huh, with the green top on it. And I put that on my head, and I'm here to tell you that my head and my hair and my scalp literally shouted hallelujah. It was almost as if I had been born again. All right? That's right. And now, because I changed the grease that I was using on my hair, at times my hair can be softer than a baby's bottom. Oh, yes, it can. Yes, it can. Praise God. And listen. You know, I'm using some humor, but all I'm trying to say is that you've got to go with what works for you. All right, you've got to recognize who you are. You've got to understand, like David said, I am fearfully and I am wonderfully made. And that's the perspective from which you need to see yourself, huh? If we don't begin to love ourselves and stop trying to be something that we are not, then we will never, ever be able to work together, which has always been devastating for our community in the long run. That's right. You know that Eurocentric canopy that I talked about? It was designed to divide us, all right? It was designed to make us suspicious of one another. It was designed to make us feel less than. That's right. It was designed to make us think that the ice is colder and that the water tastes better and that the grass is greener on the other side. It was designed to make us feel that we cannot do anything or that we cannot get anywhere unless we have a certain kind of approval from them and gain some of the material things that they might have. But every now and then, my brothers and sisters, we need to understand that less is more and that we don't necessarily need what everybody else has and go in debt trying to get it. Do you feel what I'm saying? Do you feel what I'm saying? Huh? You know, when I think about the beautiful skin tones of our people, I take off those Eurocentric glasses, and I see us for who we really are. Now, let's really be honest for a moment. When a dark-skinned person walks in the room, and I really prefer to use the terms deep and rich, when a person with a deep and rich skin tone walks in the room, if they have taken care of themselves, there's something commanding about their presence, huh? It almost seems that many people like that actually have a natural glow about them that our culture sees, but they don't want to recognize, huh? And most sisters with those deep and rich skin tones, have you ever noticed that they really don't need a whole lot of makeup, huh? David said this. David said, "I am fearfully and I am wonderfully made." David respected God's design of his own person, and that enabled him to go to God and lay the things that it were on his heart before God. And that's what all of us need to do if we really want to be the kind of person that God wants us to be. If we want to be people of character and integrity and truth and faithfulness, if we want to be right, if we want to be people of compassion, then we must, like David said, be willing to submit ourselves to the Lord so that he might lead us to the place where he would have us to go. You know, I know that many of us, having talked about all of these things, I know that many of us have personal things that we don't really like about ourselves. But that's not just us. The people of every ethnic group have personal insecurities, especially in this culture that emphasizes the vanity of physical beauty, which is temporary, instead of the more important beauty that comes from a heart that is properly related to God. But that's why David says in our text this morning, he said, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me," he said, "and then lead me in the way everlasting." My brothers and sisters, I've come here to say to you this morning, let God search you. Be open to what God sees in you. Be ready to follow God wherever he may lead you. You know, Proverbs 31 says, "Charm is deceitful and beauty is passing, but a woman," I'm going to add, "a man that fears the Lord, they will be praised, and their children will rise up and will call them blessed. And their works," the Bible says, "and their character will bring them praise in the gates of the city." My brothers and sisters, you are a reflection of God's creative genius, both inside and out. And now is the time to act like that. So don't let yourself be defined by what they have said about you, about what your mother or your grandmother in a negative way has said about you. But I want you to understand that you have been made in the image of God, and you are fearfully and you are wonderfully made. Amen. May God bless you. Praise the Lord. I want y'all to know that this morning. I want you to know that this morning. Until we love ourselves and accept us for who we are, we'll never be be able to make any more progress in this country than we have. So you got to look at yourself and look at yourself at how God sees you. And from that perspective, then you can do anything that God has ordained for you to do. I promise you that. I promise you that. Praise the Lord. The doors of the church are open.